in that document, which is pertaining to amendments in the Companies Act 2020, I have included entire section in which amendment has taken place. So that's why there is a so long document. Actually, if you look only at the amendments, we can prepare a document in 15, 20 pages also. But unless you know the whole section, or you know what was before, what is after the amendment, understanding will not be clear. So I've given you complete section. What was that before the amendment? What is the amendment? And that has been given twice. One is by way of footnote, and otherwise I have already highlighted after every section. So just let me have the document with you here. This is the document that I have shared. The Companies Amendment Act. In this, all the provisions which are amended provisions are covered herein. Then footnotes. Because the Companies Amendment Act, this entire Amendment Act did not become applicable on one day. Different dates have been given. Some of the provisions have become applicable from 1st April. So those provisions, you have to go by old provisions for the purpose of coming exam. And for the next attempt, those will be applicable. Some amendments became applicable from 1st January. Some amendments applicable in the month of March. So not all amendments are relevant for your exam. For that, relevant date is also very, very relevant. So if you remember entire amendment or all the amendments in this, then there is a possibility of you committing an error also. Because if you write the new provisions and those are not applicable as per your exam, because for the purpose of exam, all those amendments which are taken place 6 months prior to your exam, those are applicable. So focus only on those amendments which have taken place in the month of September. I've included everything. Because this document you can refer later on as well, because this is not only for the purpose of exam. So whenever you think of the Companies Amendment Act 2020, this will be relevant. Because as of now, all the provisions are applicable. Right? And after this webinar, I'm going to do a full course only on amendment, and that is available for free subscription. I've already highlighted here that is for free. So as many people want to understand Companies Amendment Act, that will be free for everyone. But interacting in the live webinar, there is no substitute for that. I'm open to answer your questions if you have any during the process. All the amendments highlighted in the different colors, that is also I have done. And on this page, I'm giving the courses which I'm running. So I'm doing complete Companies Act certification program. Then corporate and economic laws for CA final, then GST certification program, then CBLR, that is custom broker exam, then G-Card, that is also related to custom broker. And there is another one very important program, Read Fast, Learn More. This is a program for everyone who wants to learn anything in life. So regarding these, we can talk later. Right now, we are moving to the things. So should we start?
Yes, sir.
So before I really go to amendments, there are certain provisions which we should understand. Because actual Amendment Act, that is starting a little later, with some common provisions I've given. So here comes the rationalization of penalties. So here from, we have started the amendment provisions. So actually, your amendment section begins from page number 11. But before page number 11, we need to talk about some more things. Section 441, this talks about compounding of offenses. How many of you understand what is called compounding? Be very quick with me. What is called compounding of offenses? What is the effect of compounding of offenses? Anyone? What is called compounding of offenses? Why this section is relevant? Why this section is relevant? one time settlement. No. I'm coming. Okay. So why this section is relevant here? The reason for explaining this section is there is a rationalization of lots of penalties out of total 65 amendments. 46 amendments are pertaining to penalties only. Penalties either removed or reduced or rationalized. Now, what has happened is number of places where imprisonment was also provided. Okay. So imprisonment, that was one of the penalties given for number of offenses. How this was given? This said imprisonment with or without fine. And other category was fine with or without imprisonment. What is the difference between the two? In this case, imprisonment is compulsory, fine may or may not be there. In this case, fine is compulsory, imprisonment may or may not be there. Okay. So the offenses for which imprisonment is compulsory, these are not compoundable offenses. So any offense where imprisonment is a compulsory penalty, then that is not compoundable. Now coming this side, there is a fine. Imprisonment may or may not be there. It is already provided in the law. In this case, this is compoundable. But that requires permission of the court because the penalty of imprisonment is there, right? Who can award imprisonment? That is the court. So compoundable with court's permission. So as far as imprisonment is concerned, what is the effect on compounding of offenses? Don't use the word composition. That is a different word. Compounding. So imprisonment with or without fine, those offenses are not compoundable. Often, and if the imprisonment is there, but that is said fine with or without imprisonment, then those offenses are compoundable with the permission of court. So which offenses are always compoundable? Quickly, which offenses are always compoundable? Offenses which are punishable with fine only. Fine means in terms of money. Those are always compoundable. So here, where imprisonment is compulsory, not compoundable, fine with or without imprisonment, it is compoundable, requiring permission of the court. And the offenses which are punishable with fine only, those are always compoundable. So when I talked about rationalization and decriminalization, what has happened from majority of the places, or you can say almost from all the places, the concept of imprisonment has been removed, which are relating to day-to-day business operations of the company. Almost gone. there is a penalty for imprisonment, but when the offense is something serious, if it is a matter related to fraud, if it is affecting the public in general, then there is imprisonment. But in a general, as far as common provisions are concerned, the concept of imprisonment has been almost removed from all the places. So what has happened? Now those are the offenses punishable with fine only. So when those are punishable with fine only, it means earlier those were compoundable with the permission of the court. Now directly those are compoundable. Major effect of Companies Amendment Act 2020. Have you got this? Tell me quickly, have you got this? What is the impact of the amendments? The major amendment. Compounding. Section 441. Now you can categorize those in three categories of offenses. These are imprisonment, then fine, with or without imprisonment, and fine only. These are not compoundable. These are compoundable with the permission of court. These are always compoundable. So majority of the offenses under the act have been moved to or shifted to compoundable offense. Right. Now, who will compound the offense? Who is the authority for compounding of offenses? That depends upon maximum fine. Up to rupees 25 lakhs. And it is exceeding 25 lakhs plus. In this case, regional director can compound the offense. And in this case only, tribunal can compound the offense. So, I haven't explained to you the meaning of the word compositions or rather compounding. So compounding is a process in which any person, either company or officer or employee of the company who's committed any default punishable with fine only or fine with or without imprisonment, he can make an application for the compounding. For what? So number one reason for compounding is it is a voluntary disclosure of the offense committed. And the purpose of voluntary disclosure to get the relief against a possible prosecution and penalty later on. What is the impact of the compounding? Impact is getting relief against possible prosecution and penalty that may come later on because of the offense. So why not to put an end to all those possibilities of the penalties in future? That is called compounding. So compounding is the process in which either company or officer or employee of the company, government officers cannot apply for that. They can make an application for compounding of the offenses. Offense means not only one offense. You can make a single application for multiple offenses. Depending upon what is the maximum penalty prescribed therein, the office or the authority will be determined who will be compounding the offense. So if that aggregate amount for the fine is not exceeding 25 lakh, the compounding will be done by the regional director. Otherwise, it will be done by the tribunal. But in either case, you have to make an application to the ROC, or rather through the ROC. Make an application through the ROC, and ROC will determine the amount, and accordingly he will proceed, he will forward the application either to the tribunal or to the regional director. Right. Now, what time application should be made for compounding? Before the institution of the prosecution proceedings or after that? So if it is before, nothing can be done. It means prosecution cannot be started unless this application is disposed of. And if it is done later on, then the prosecution already started will come to end till this application is disposed of. And once it is compounded, then there cannot be any further prosecution for the same offense, but only limitation restriction is similar offense cannot be compounded within a period of 3 years. Similar offense cannot be compounded within a period of 3 years. So it should not become a tradition, it should not become a practice that commit an offense or apply for compounding, commit an offense, apply for compounding. That should not happen. Because if it is repeated within 3 years, there is no authority for compounding of those offenses and the person is likely to be punished. And in that case, no escape will be there. Nikunj, good evening. How are you? Aggregation of offenses. Okay.
Good evening, sir. I'm fine.
So everybody can hear, or there is, Pugaz is saying no sound. Pugaz, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. I am hearing, sir.
Okay. So is the concept of compounding is clear? So this is certainly not a settlement, right? This is not a settlement. You may end up paying even more than the actual fine. But you know what happens? If you pay a penalty, how do you account for that? Compounding fees can be paid out of, or rather, this is a valid legal expenditure. Number two, no disqualification is incurred by paying the compounding fees, but by paying the fine or penalty, disqualifications are incurred. Amount payable herein may be more. Right? So this is not a settlement. So that's why I said the concept is different. So what is the compounding? Number one, voluntary disclosure, right? By whom? This is company and its officers. Intentionally mentioned that so that this scheme is not open for the government officers. So if they commit an offense, no compounding here under the company there. Purpose, seeking protection against possible prosecution and penalty. So what is the protection actually? I said you may end up paying more fine than what is actually payable as a fine. Protection is that whatever is paid here, that does not become a disqualification. By paying the fine, there is a disqualification. Schedule 5, managerial personnel, amount exceeding 1,000 rupees. Compounding fees paid even 5 lakhs, not a disqualification under Schedule 5. But fine paid more than 1,000, that becomes a disqualification there. So that is one example under the Companies Act. There may be some more examples under the other laws where the disqualification is incurred by paying the fine. So this is a way out. So this is, I said, it is a voluntary disclosure. Now, at what time? Application can be made before the launch of prosecution for the offense or after the launch of prosecution. And if it is made before the launch, then prosecution cannot be launched until this application has been rejected. If the offense is compounded, certainly it cannot be issued. and if the prosecution has already been started, in that case also person can go for compounding of the offenses, and the process of prosecution gets stayed then and there. And if it is compounded, prosecution will come to end. So that is a big protection given. Now, what is the amendment there? And I said, many offenses where imprisonment was provided, that has been removed. So if that has been removed, it means now application for compounding can be made as soon as the person comes to know that this kind of offense has been committed. Okay, so this is section 441. See here. Now in this itself also there is an amendment at the end. This says, if any officer or other employee of the company who fails to comply with the order made by the tribunal or the regional director or any officer authorized by the central government under subsection 4, the maximum amount of fine for the offense proposed to be compounded under this section shall be twice the amount provided in the corresponding section in which punishment for such an offense is provided. So this itself is the amended section. This is having the effect. So now what is said is, if compounding has been done and if the person concerned fails to fulfill the direction given by the tribunal or the regional director or some other officer authorized by the government, then what will happen? Earlier, there was an imprisonment. I'll show you the footnote. Can you read this footnote on the screen?
It is already at the bottom.
Earlier, what was given? Earlier, it was said that any officer or other employee of the company who fails to comply with the order made by the tribunal or regional director or any officer authorized by the central government under subsection 4 shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 6 months. Now, the term of concept of imprisonment is altogether gone here from. Right. Plus, they say a fine not exceeding 1 lakh or both. That is also gone. Now, what has come in is, they say double the amount of the fine given in that section. What he will be punishable? Double the amount. But this is the fine. Fine for what? Fine for failure to comply with the directions given by the tribunal or regional director. So this is also one of the amendments in this area. Tell me, is this portion clear? Or you have any question on this section? Now, this is another section which is referred at number of places, section 447 under the Companies Act. At least 10 sections are there which are punishable under section 447. At least 10 sections are there. Right? Wherever public interest is there, wherever fraud is there, this section comes into picture. What is called a fraud?
So intentionally misinterpreting or doing the window dressing.
Pardon?
Intentionally doing something mistake and window dressing the books of account and like that.
What is called a fraud? What you said is more or less right. Fraud is number one. This is intentional. Intentional what? This is either misrepresentation or suppression of facts . Getting it? Intentional. If the misrepresentation is there, but the intention is not involved, what it will be called as? Kya naam denge usko agar wo intentional nahi hai to?
Negligence.
Mistake, negligence, certainly. राइट जो डिफरेंस गलती और झूठ में है, यू अंडरस्टैंड गलती और झूठ का क्या अंतर है? गलती मीन्स द पर्सन हिमसेल्फ मे नॉट बी इवन अवेयर ऑफ दैट दैट इट इज नॉट अ राइट और करेक्ट रिप्रेजेंटेशन. Jude means he knows the fact and is still making the wrong representation. So that is intention. So this is something intentional. Misrepresentation or separation of fact and with the object of with the object of unlawful gain and or causing unlawful loss. What is called fraud? Number one, intentional. So in the company, can a company be punished for fraud? Logical question to you. Can a company be punished for fraud?
No, sir. Only the concerned has been punished.
Why not? Why company cannot be punished?
It's a legal entity, not a natural person.
That is okay, but again, my
officers and directors.
Hmm?
It's been represented by its officers and directors. It's a legal entity, not a natural person.
How does it make a difference whether legal entity or natural?
Sir, unless the directors will do something, company ka kuch ho nahi sakta. It's a lifting of corporate veil, something.
Dekho.
Okay.
Answer lies in this. Legal entity, body, corporate cannot have the intention. Who will have the intention?
Individual.
Only individual. Simple logic. Got it? Right? So, you see, don't try to remember anything. Understand, and it is understood for the lifetime. Okay. If you try to remember, all possibilities you forget. But if you try to understand, chances are you will never ever forget these things. So I said these are only directors, officers, individual are punishable. Why? Because this is intentional and only individual can have the intent. Got it? I'll show you there. See here.
Sir, got it.
This is without prejudice to any liability, including repayment of the debt under this act or any other law for the driving force. This is any person who is found to be guilty of any amount of 10 lakhs, so this is a percentage, this I'll explain you a little later. Okay, now see here, the fraud. What is the meaning of fraud? In relation to affairs of the company or body corporate, includes any act, omission, concealment of fact or abuse of position committed by any person or any person with the connivance of any manner. Connivance is what? What is the meaning of connivance? जिसको हम हिंदी मिली भगत कहते हैं, दैट इज दैट. विथ इंटेंट, सो दिस वर्ड इज वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, इंटेंट. सो देयर फ्रॉम आई सेड दिस इज ओनली एंड ओनली फॉर द इंडिविजुअल. व्हेन वी आर यूजिंग द वर्ड पर्सन, वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट इंडिविजुअल. पर्सन इंक्लूड्स आर्टिफिशियल ऑल्सो, नेचुरल एंटिटी और अदर लीगल एंटिटी ऑल्सो, बट हेयर द वर्ड पर्सन ओनली मीन्स a natural person. There has to be an individual, right? Then the question is, what for all that being is done? Why the misrepresentation? Why separation of fact? Why collusion is being done?
For the sake of benefit, like getting loans from the financial institutions and like others.
With the object of having unlawful gain or causing unlawful loss to another person. Unlawful gain means what that person is not entitled for. Right? Maybe company is not entitled for something, but he is making a false representation to somebody, that is a fraud. right? I give you a real example. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
A real example, what I have gone through myself. 2015, I booked a flat in Mumbai. And I booked a flat on the top floor of the building which was being constructed. Construction had just begun. And the builder sold me the top floor. Possession was supposed to be given to me by 2017, June. June 17, the work has not even done 50%. Waited for one more year. Nothing done. Complaint filed with the police. Other action taken. Later on, we found that the builder who had sold me that floor did not even had the permission to construct that floor what he had sold. He did not even had the permission to construct that floor which was sold. Now see here, whether it was a misrepresentation or not.
Sir.
Sir.
What was the object?
Unlawful gain and loss.
And at the same time?
Unlawful loss to the person.
Causing unlawful loss.
What I don't deserve, if I'm losing that money, that is my unlawful loss. What he is getting, he is not entitled for, that is an unlawful gain. And the origin of that is lying in the misrepresentation, so that is a fraud. Why I'm telling you this section? Because this is a very, very powerful section, and even police officers do not know about this. Whenever there is a complaint against the company, ensure that you refer section 447 therein. Cheating and fraud, this becomes something very, very powerful. And why I'm telling you is because when I got it mentioned in the FIR, and when the police officer read this, he said this is much more powerful than the penalty given under IPC also. Under IPC, it is imprisonment up to 7 years. That doesn't talk about the repayment of the money. This section says the penalty is in addition to repayment. Repayment has to be done plus imprisonment plus the penalty that can be up to 3 times of the amount involved. So this is much more powerful than what is there in the IPC. Even police officers are not aware of. So be careful about this. This is a very, very powerful tool in your hands. Right. So fraud is when intentionally a misrepresentation or suppression of fact is done and the object is unlawful gain or causing unlawful damage, then that person is punishable under section 447. And under section 447, what is the penalty? Penalty. This is in addition to refund. Right. So this penalty, what we are talking about, the section itself said that this is in addition to the liability for the making the refund. How much amount, how much is the penalty? That depends upon how much amount is involved therein. $10 lakhs or 1% of company's turnover. And less amount. How much amount is involved in the fraud? 10 lakhs or 1% and out of the two, again, whichever is less. In this case, again, two parts, imprisonment and fine. Imprisonment minimum 6 months, maximum 10 years, fine minimum 100%, maximum, this is 300%. And further it is said that if a public interest is involved, then minimum imprisonment is 3 years. This is only based on the amount, and if public interest also get involved, the amount of penalty or the duration of imprisonment is minimum 3 years. Minimum 3 years if public interest is involved. Right. If the amount is less, then what? In that case, that says the fine can go up to 50 lakhs. Imprisonment may or may not be there. But condition is no public interest. If public interest is there, only this is applicable. This is applicable only if there is no public interest. Only if there is no public interest. So if public interest is not there, then the amount of imprisonment can be less. See here, this one. Read it. This is provided that where the fraud involves an amount less than 10 lakhs to 1% of the turnover of the company, whichever is lower, and does not involve public interest. So that is what I have mentioned here. If public interest is involved, only this is applicable. So if the public interest is not involved, any person guilty of the fraud shall be punishable with imprisonment, which may extend it to 5 years. So this is not saying minimum. So that is starting from zero, or fine that may extend up to 50 lakhs or both. Here the minimum imprisonment is also there. In this case, minimum imprisonment is not there. So that is up to 5 years. Fine is also up to 50 lakhs or both. See here. Imprisonment and fine. This is up to 5 years. This is up to 50 lakhs or both. So when I say up to means what?
Minimum can be zero.
Minimum can be zero. Exactly. Because in this case, minimum is given 6 months. In this case, minimum is not given. It means their imprisonment may be there, may not be there. And fine may be there, may not be there. Or both can be there. So lots of discretion available here. But in this case, not much discretion. Minimum 6 months imprisonment. And that too, if public interest is involved, minimum imprisonment shall be 3 years. And then maximum imprisonment can go up to 10 years. So I told you that this section is actually much more powerful than the provisions under IPC for the purpose of fraud. Because that is only talking about the imprisonment. Here we have said in addition to this, then there is imprisonment plus there is fine also. This is much more powerful section. Got this?
Yes, sir.
So this is a very, very important section which you should be aware of. Okay? Now, moving to next one. Now, section 450, this is punishment where no specific penalty is provided. This is another amendment. Under almost every section, we have penalties. We have one section, 172. 172 is pertaining to directors, and that is in relation to a qualification and appointment of director. Last section, 149, penalty. So that says if no specific penalty prescribed, then that is a penalty under the 172. Similarly, this is the section which is under any section. If a penalty is not prescribed, then that is also punishable under section 450. So there is no situation where no punishment is proven. Right, is what happens. Lots of people don't come up to section 450. For them, syllabus will end. Right. And what will happen that they'll not understand that penalty is not given in the section. It means there is no penalty. There is a penalty under section 450. How much can be the penalty? This is also an amended provision actually. Right? Read it in the full. This is if a company or any officer of the company or any other person contravenes any of the provisions of the act or the rules made thereunder, or condition or limitation, restriction subject to which approval, etc. has been given, And if no penalty is given, what is the penalty? Liable to pay penalty of 10,000 rupees and case of continuing penalty, further fine of 1,000 per day, but subject to a maximum of 2 lakhs rupees. And if it is an officer, then the amount becomes maximum 50,000. So any offense, any requirement under the Act, any permission, any sanction given subject to condition, and if those are not fulfilled, what is the fine? So starting with the 10,000 rupees, that is the first fine, and then further fine up to rupees 1,000 per day. And then depends upon whether it is a company or individual. If it is individual, maximum fine is 50,000 rupees. And if it is a company, maximum fine can go up to rupees 2 lakhs. So section 450, let us make another chart on this. Section. This says penalty where no specific penalty prescribed. And then minimum penalty then continuing and then maximum penalty. Minimum penalty rupees 10,000. Continuing penalty rupees 1,000 per day. And maximum penalty in case of company, it can go up to 3 lakhs. And in case of individual, it can go up to 50,000 rupees. So any section, because you will find certain sections from which penalty clause have been removed. What does it mean? No penalty. No, it doesn't mean there is no penalty. That will become punishable under section 450, plus that will also be punishable under other laws. So double penalties will be there. So when some specific penalty is removed from the section, number one, that is a common penalty. So no penalty prescribed under the section, it means that is punishable under section 450, plus other laws are also applicable. What is the minimum penalty? Under this section, company and officer both can be punished. Minimum penalty is rupee 10,000 plus if it is a continuing offense, then 1,000 rupee per day. And maximum penalty for the company, it can be up to 3 lakhs. In case of individual, it can be up to rupees 50,000. I think this is a mistake I have committed. This is 2 lakhs, not 3 lakhs. Please correct that. Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, coming to section 454, this is also a very powerful section.
Yes, sir. Sir, please ask the disturbance. Everyone, because the background sound is coming.
By chance, if your mic is open, please keep it on mute, and you always have the right to unmute and speak to me. Because otherwise, that is disturbing everybody in common. Okay, so you have a right to unmute. As soon as our discussion is over, please ensure that your mic is on mute. Now, section 454, again, this is also something very, very powerful. Adjudication of penalties. Who will determine that somebody is liable to fine or penalty? Now, let me ask you one thing. This will clarify. See, if amount is given, what is the difference in these amounts? These words, punishable and liable.
Liable by the authority, somebody, and liable means self liable as per the sections of the Act of.
Wherever the word punishable comes, this is criminal. So, the main thing that has happened in the amendment is decriminalization. Right. So, word punishable itself has been substituted at number of places with the word liable. And in this also, now let me ask you another question. This says, for example, amount up to rupees 1 lakh. And it says, what are the difference?
The second case, it is constant. In the first case, it can vary up to maybe 0 and up to 1 lakh.
What will be the exact meaning?
In the first case, the amount up to 1 lakh, it depends on the circumstances.
In this case, this is starting from what is minimum?
Zero.
Starting from zero, it can go up to
one lakh.
Okay, so this becomes a discretion, and that this power was exercisable by the judicial authority. Now, when this amount is here, and what is given herein?
Specific fine is prescribed.
Exact amount has been given. So here the only thing available to be decided by the officer is whether contravention has taken place or not. If contravention is there, fine is already fixed. He doesn't have a choice. This is not there. Number of places this has happened, and that we are going to see. So that's why this section 454 about the adjudication, because lots of offenses, contraventions have been brought in the Companies Act under internal adjudication mechanism. Lots of offenses have been brought under that category. So amount of fine has been amended in this manner. Instead of this, now the amount you will find in majority of the cases is written this way. So when the amount is written this way, it means now the matter will not go to the judicial authority. Matter will be decided by the adjudicating authority appointed by the central government at the rank of ROC or senior officer. So they are going to determine, and amount of offense, amount of fine is already fixed. So they don't have a choice. So all this I'm giving you as a background, because once you understand, you see, amendments, you can find number of places that these are the amendment, these are amendment, these are amendment. But what are the consequences of that? Nobody will explain you that. That is what I'm doing. See here, adjudication of penalty. They say the central government may by order published in the official gazette appoint any officer of the central government not below the rank of ROC registrar as adjudicating officer for adjudging the penalty under the provisions of this act in the manner as may be prescribed. So instead of the matter being taken to the judicial authority and it is being penal, person being prosecuted therein, then offense being proved, then amount of penalty being decided, then appeal being filed, all that is gone. All that is gone. Amount of penalty is fixed. It is only adjudged by the officer. And this procedure has been given. That a show cause notice has to be given, reply of that will come, etc., etc. Now, this is an amendment in this section itself. This is provided that in case of default and related to non-compliance of subsection 4 of section 92. What is that section 192? Any idea? Section 92. That is the filing of annual return. And or subsection 2 of section 137. What does it relate to? Filing of financial statements. You remember disqualification under section 164, directors? If annual return and financial statements are not filed for 3 consecutive years, what happens? Disqualification for directors for the period of 5 years. Right. So here what is said is that provided that in case of defaults relate to non-compliance of subsection 4 of section 92, that is failure to file the annual return, or under subsection 1 or 2 of section 137, that is failure to file the financial statements, and such a default is rectified either prior to or within 30 days of the issue of the notice by the adjudicating authority, no penalty shall be imposed. These are two sections specifically given that if the show cause notice is issued for the penalty and the person rectifies before that or within 30 days after the receiving the notice, no penalty on that, right? So this itself is an amendment, and you may be asked a question on this because this is a part of your syllabus, right? Section 92, 137, failure to file financial statement, failure to file annual return. What are the penalties? So penalties are there, but if you file before the issue of the notice or you file within 30 days after the issue of notice, then no penalty will be applicable. Okay. Now, here is a summary of many offenses. One by one, we will go into the details. Yes, this is something very, very important. So, here from, do we have any student or any CA student here? All CS students?
Yes, sir, CS students.
Okay. And this CS is final?
Yes, sir, final.
Okay. So if it is ACLP, by chance, if it is ACLP, then your syllabus ends up to what section?
ACLP.
If it is advanced company law practice, then your syllabus ends up to section?
448.
No. For advanced company law practice, old syllabus, CS professional, syllabus ends at section 205. After section 205, what are the provisions? Right, the provisions are regarding inspection, inquiry, investigation, compromise, arrangement, operation mismanagement, producer companies, winding up, government companies, foreign companies, NCLT, appellate tribunal, and miscellaneous provisions. All these are not a part of your syllabus. Your syllabus ends at section 205. So up to section 205, there are 40 amendments. Out of 40, there are few amendments which are really, really important. Like this one, the first one that we are seeing, section 2, subsection 52. Directly somebody will ask a question, and this is affecting section 23 also. Directly related, section 2, subsection 52 and section 23, these are related. There is a new section 129A. Then there are provisions under section 149 regarding the appointment of independent director. Then related provisions are under section 197 regarding managerial remuneration. These are some major relevant changes for which you can be asked a question in the exam. Other provisions are in majority of the cases, those are in relation to penalty. Some other amendments are also there, like say, for example, under section 62, when we talk about the right issue, the time limit required to be given to the existing members for exercising the right has been reduced. Earlier that was minimum 15 days. Now it says either 15 days or lesser time has been prescribed. So wherever there is a major change in the operation of the law, that you have to remember in any case. Wherever penalty has been rationalized, then in any case, we are going to see. Generally, your exam does not contain provisions or they do not have the questions relating to penalty. But this time, major changes are there. That's why you are expected to know these penalties as well. Subsequently, penalties will not be very important. But this time, the coming exam, those are important. So right now, we have definition of the term listed company. What is the meaning of listed company? Yes,
232.
Okay, what is the meaning of the term listing?
Getting enrolled with the stock exchanges. Listing is the process of getting enrolled with the stock exchanges.
What is the purpose?
Purpose to raise the funds from the market and to
freely trade securities in the market.
listing, simply you can define this is a permission granted by the stock exchange for the trading of company securities on the platform of the stock exchange. What is that? Repeat.
To permit, sir?
I said repeat what I said. Lenovo, whatever I have shared, that is equally applicable for old syllabus, new syllabus, doesn't make a difference. What is listing? Listing is a permission granted by stock exchange for trading of companies' securities on the stock exchange.
That is a secondary market. Yes, sir.
Certainly secondary market. Okay. So listing, when the listing is done? Before the issue or after the issue?
Before the issue, sir.
Before the issue.
Gaurish, CA final also, company law remains same. That's why no change. Amendments are there also equally applicable. Okay. So we are talking about the amendments and whatever material I have shared, that is in any case having all the amendments applicable in the entire act. Let me give you about some background about the listing. In the listing, we have two types. One is called pre-listing, and another is referred as only listing. Pre-listing is before the issue of prospectus. Before issue of prospectus, and this is after allotment. The purpose of this is getting the permission of the stock exchange to list the securities post allotment. This, what is the meaning of the pre-listing? This is only permission. Of a stock exchange to list securities after allotment. So what is the exact meaning of listing? This pre-listing, this is not a listing at all. When you propose to issue a prospectus to public, you are required to mention the name of the stock exchange where securities will be listed. And you cannot refer the name of the stock exchange unless you have taken the permission from the stock exchange to refer that name. So getting the permission of a stock exchange that we are coming out with the public issue and we want to list the securities in the stock exchange, that permission itself is called a pre-listing. There's not a listing at all. This does not bind the stock exchange. This does not bind the company. No binding effect at all. Company have made an application to the stock exchange and tomorrow decides to withdraw the issue, no problems. The stock exchange has given the permission that yes, we will list after the allotment, but the company fails to fulfill the obligations. Stock exchange refuses to list, no problems. Actual listing is this. Actual listing is this. Okay. Got this one? What is the difference in listing?
Sir.
Now, this listing, this listing can be in recognized stock exchange and other stock exchange. Listing can be in the recognized stock exchange and other stock exchange. What is the meaning of recognized stock exchange? Recognized by SEBI, correct. So where those stock exchanges are? These are recognized by SEBI. So where these stock exchanges are? Those are in India or outside India?
In India, sir.
Certainly those are in India.
India.
These stock exchanges are outside India. These are outside India. Right. Now, subject to this, now I'll show you the definition. You can interpret the meaning automatically. Now read the definition of listed company. What is said is listed company means a company which has any of the securities listed on. Where it is listed?
Recognized stock exchange.
And where it is?
In India.
That is in India. So if a security is listed outside India, not here, whether it will be a listed company or not?
Yes, sir. Will be listed company.
No. Where those are listed, see the word.
Oh, sorry, sir. Recognized stock exchange.
Yes, that is what I have highlighted. So if it is not listed here, it will not be called as a listed company. Got the meaning clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, further it says, now another amendment here. Provided that such a class of companies which have listed or intend to list any class of securities as may be prescribed in consultation with the SEBI shall not be considered as a listed company. So this amendment has been brought in the company's specification of the definition rules, and this is a public company which has issued the debt instruments, non-convertible debentures and non-convertible redeemable preference shares. Private companies, those are issuing the non-convertible debt instruments. So even if those are listed on the recognized stock exchange, still those will not be considered as a listed company. So two types of companies will not be considered as listed companies. Unlisted companies, only for the reference, I'm explaining. This is not the definition of unlisted company. Listed outside India and listing of NCD or non-convertible preference shares in recognized stock exchange. No listing of equity shares. So if it is listed only outside India, it is not listed in the recognized stock exchange in India, that is certainly not a listed company. There are other things that it may be listed in the recognized stock exchange, but only NCD and non-convertible preference shares. Equity shares are not listed, that will also not be considered as a listed company. So this is public companies which have not listed their equity shares on the recognized stock exchange. But what they have listed? Non-convertible debt instrument, that is debentures. Non-convertible redeemable preference shares. Private companies, non-convertible debentures. Right. So those I have not divided into private public. Simply I said those have issued the non-convertible debentures or those have issued the non-convertible redeemable preference shares. If those are listed but not the equity share, those will not be considered as listed companies. So big change in the definition. Now see here, this is the summary of the amendment. This is the central government has been empowered to exclude certain companies based on listing of certain securities on recognized stock exchange as may be provided in the rules. And thus the companies which list only debt securities may be excluded from the condition of a listed company for the purpose of Companies Act. This is a summary of the entire amendment. Okay. So everywhere I have given it that way. So you can read the whole section, get to know the whole thing. At the end, I have given you summary. Now, under Section 8, what is the Section 8 company?
charitable companies whose objects are to for charitable only.
Sir, not for profit company.
Not for profit company.
No,
what happens if the profit is there?
No declaration of dividends, sir.
These are called as no profit companies, but that is a myth. The reality is these are no dividend companies. These companies are engaged or proposed to be engaged in the social activity, charitable activities, or promotion of art, science, culture, religion, charity, etc. They don't intend to make profit, but if the profit is there, that profit will be applied in the promotion of the business activity, then it will not be distributed by way of dividend. So intention is not to make the profit. If the profit is there, right, profit will be applied in the business, that will not be distributed by way of dividend. Now the question is, can they carry on the activity without profit objective? A logical question to you. Can they carry on the business with the object of making profit?
Yes, sir. Profit. They can, because they need to raise funds, and if it is coming from the profit, that will be used for only for charitable purpose. They cannot distribute through dividend.
So, correct. Object, no. So you see, as I said, no profit company. That is a myth. Whatever be the amount of capital of the company, if it doesn't generate profit, the capital will certainly end on one day, isn't it? So even for sustaining, it is required to make the profit. Profit is not to be shared by way of dividend, that is to be applied in the furtherance of the same business activity, right? And when the license is there, under Section 8, certain obligations are there. What are the obligations? The major obligations are, first of all, the members are not eligible to get any share in the profit. Number two, no amendment in the memorandum article without the permission of the court, and certain other conditions are applicable. So in the penalties, some changes are there at the end directly we are going to. So what is said here in? See here, if a company makes any default and comply with any of the requirements laid down in the section, what are the requirements? So basically, that is given the three things: object, number two, how to deal with the profit, and then some other requirements are there. So this says the company shall, without prejudice to any other action under the provisions of the section, be punishable with fine which is not less than 10 lakhs, and it can go up to 1 crore. Minimum 10 lakhs up to rupees 1 crore. And directors and every officer of the company shall be punishable. Now see, this is what. What was before that? Read it. Read the footnote. What it is saying?
Omitted by the company's amendment of 2020, dated 28th September 20, before it was
released. With imprisonment, which may extend to 3 years. So this portion has been removed. So imprisonment concept is gone totally. So what is punishable is only fine. This is punishable with fine, which shall not be less than 25,000. It can go up to rupees 25 lakhs. So what is removed therefrom? The term imprisonment is gone. So when the imprisonment is gone, that's why I told you that now this offense is compoundable. It is compoundable or not? When any contravention, any offense is punishable with fine only, that becomes compoundable. So whether it will be compoundable or not?
Sir, this is compoundable because imprisonment word has been deleted.
The term imprisonment is altogether gone. Right. So, and this is certainly a case where the range is given. So it's still, this is a matter of adjudication by the judicial authority, not by the officer. When the amount is fixed, then that will be determined by the adjudicating authority appointed under this act. Rectification of the name of company. What is called rectification of name? What is called rectification of name?
Any change in the name of company?
Hmm?
Any change in the name of company?
आपकी आवाज नहीं है।
After allotment of the name coincides with the existing or some unlawful name, then the activation will be
change versus rectification. What is the difference? Change is this is voluntary and this is at any time. Rectification, this is only correction of an error. And what is the error? Name of company is undesirable. And what is the meaning of the word undesirable here?
Not as per requirement.
No. Not as per
some economy. Kind of slogan which is not acceptable by the India and some logo of Ashok Chakra, which is only permitted for the government companies.
In this section, only two things are given. Number one, name too closely resembles with the name of an existing company. Number two, this is resembling the registered trademark of another person. It is not resembling the name of company, but it is resembling the registered trademark of another person. Only two situations given. See here. So this says, in the opinion of the central government, two nearly resembles the name of a company in existence had been previously registered, etc., etc. So that is one case. Another situation is given here. This is application is made by the proprietor of the trademark, etc. So only two situations are referred here. When I say undesirable, so actually there is a long list when the name is considered undesirable. In this first case is too closely resembles name of an existing company and again closely resembles registered trademark of another person. Only two situations are given. Right. In this case, central government can issue directions to company. When, within how much time direction can be issued? Any time limit?
I think 6 months.
45 days.
Under Companies Act 1956, there was a time limit. In this, there is no time limit. Okay. Now, if it is resembling the name registered trademark of another person, in this case, trademark owner files complaint with the central government. Now see the difference. What is happening in this case? Government is directly issuing direction to the company. In this case, the name is not resembling the name of another company, but it is resembling the registered trademark of another person. So MCA doesn't have the record of trademark. There is a separate ministry altogether, right? So in this case, the trademark owner should come to the central government that this is resembling my name. Then the central government can issue directions to the company. This is within the time limit, within 3 years from the date of incorporation or from the date when the name has become too closely identical.
Yes, no, I have a point to ask in this, sir.
Yes, please. Bully.
Yeah, sir. Here, for a name closely resembles, actually, some there is a point for reserving or preserving the name, application of name. Hmm. That time, ROC not rejected whether it is resembling to closely some existing company.
No, this can happen only by mistake. Generally, it will never happen.
Yes, that is what I asked, sir.
No, generally, I have not seen even a single case till now.
That is, sir. Thank you, sir.
I have not seen even a single case. So since it is in the part of law, I am explaining. Otherwise, I would have said that this is no more practical. So companies are not registered with undesirable name.
Yes, sir.
So by chance, so if by this may happen because the name of company can be registered with very closely resembling the name of another company. Right. Like, you know, the company which is Microsoft. What is the product of the company Microsoft?
Computer manufacturer software.
Which software? Which is the most common software?
So Microsoft Dynamics, that accounting software, Navision. And
the most common is MS Office.
MS Office, yes. Microsoft,
right.
MS Office.
So tomorrow you go and register the company with MS Office Private Limited.
They will not leave.
No, that is MS Office Private Limited is not resembling the name of any other company, but it is closely resembling the registered trademark of another person.
Yes, sir.
They can file a complaint here, right? And when they file a complaint, then central government will issue a direction, right? In this case, then central government issues directions. Now, giving the direction is one part. What after the direction? Now comes amendment. Now see very carefully. Up to this portion, you have noted?
Okay. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now close this chart. And you keep on writing below that. Any such direction shall be complied with by a company within 3 months. So directions given by the government, that is okay. But what company should do? What is written here? The company?
Mandatory. Shall mandatory.
Right. So there is no choice. Company has to do that. And for that, ordinary resolution is required. If you want to change the name, a special resolution is required. But this is rectification of name on the direction given by central government. Only ordinary resolution is needed. You pass a special, good enough. But what is required by law? An ordinary resolution. Right. Now, further amendment done by company, and this is not done by company. Direction is given. Company has to comply with the direction within a period of 3 months. By passing a special an ordinary resolution, if company completes that, what happens? Matter closes. Okay, because that is the purpose. If not done, what will happen? This is another amendment. This portion. central government can allot another name to company first option is given to whom first option is given for changing the name is to the company that you pass an ordinary resolution and their name will get changed if company does not do it then what is happening central government can allot another name who changing the name of company now
central government is changing
the government is changing this has never this was never there before this is something very powerful change we'll see the section later on right so central government can allot the new name a government allots so from that date the new name will come into operation and then so if company doesn't like that name company can change that later on so that will not be called a rectification that will be called a change rectification is here right so once the central government has given a direction the company should comply with the direction within a period of 3 months and if company does not in that situation the central government can allot another name and thereafter company can change so if company does not want this will continue I hope you got this
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now see this. This is section 16. Okay. So this is in the opinion. The company shall change their new name in case within a period of. What is the time limit given?
3 months.
3 months.
3 months. Okay. This was already there. This is not an amendment. Amendment is in second part. This here. On application of the registered proprietor of the trademark, then the name is identical or too closely resembles to the registered trademark of the proprietor, made to the central government within 3 years. In this case, again, the time limit is? What is the time limit given for compliance? 3 months.
3 months.
This was 6 months earlier. This was? 6 months. So now there is a uniformity. So whether direction is being given by the government under clause A or the direction are being given under clause B doesn't make a difference. The time limit is only 3 months. Right. So earlier there was a difference. In clause A, time limit is 3 months. In clause B, time limit is 6 months. But now it is uniformity in both the cases, either case. So if the direction is being given by the central government under section 16, the time limit given to the company for complying with the direction is 3 months. Right. Now this is another amendment. See here in red, number 3. Subsection 3. Read it on your own.
Yes, sir.
Okay, what you explained that government can that is the point only, sir.
Yes, yes. You see, what I'm doing is when I write on the board, I make the things much more simple for you. So ultimately, what do you need to refer later on? Your notebook, you cannot read these 200 pages every time. Isn't it? So what I'm trying to do is that I'm giving you the full section that you can read the whole section along with the amendments. Plus you understand it from here. So the things become easier for you. Okay. So this is section 16. Now see further. Provided that nothing in this action shall prevent a company from subsequently changing the name. This is the word used is changing. It is not a rectification. Okay. See here. These are summary. The time limit is reduced from 6 months to 3 months and the government can allot. Then there were earlier penalty provisions were there. Those have been omitted. The penalty provisions were there in the section. Those have been completely removed. So removed means now those are punishable under section 450, 10,000 plus 1,000 rupee per day going up to 2 lakhs. And in case of individual, 10,000 plus 1,000 per day, maximum 50,000 rupees. So those are punishable there. Okay. Now section 23, public offer and private placement. Public offer and private placement. In this section, some more amendments are there. and these amendments are. So section 2, subsection 52, listed companies, where those are making the listing is being done in the stock exchange other than recognized stock exchange. So outside India, if they can issue. So this section is authorizing that one. Subsection 3 says, such a class of public companies may issue the class of securities for the purpose of listing the permitted stock exchange in a permissible foreign jurisdiction. Before this, any offer to public, that was a public issue by the company. Now, if the public issue is being made in a foreign jurisdiction, listing is being done there, it will not be considered as a listed company for India. I hope you are getting the difference.
Sir, please come again, sir.
Earlier, before this, what happened is, anytime you issue a prospectus to public, public means in India or anywhere in the world, listing was compulsory in India. Right? That was the provision. Now this is saying that companies are authorized to issue specified securities in the foreign territories only. So when they're authorized to issue securities there, the listing will be done there only. And those are not listed in India. Those will not be considered as listed company for the purpose of India. Right. Suppose by chance tomorrow you issue some global receipts outside India. Right. And you're not issuing any securities in India. You are already listed in LSE, you are already listed in BS, or you are already listed in NSE, etc. That is New York Stock Exchange, but not in India. Should you be considered as a listed company or not?
No, sir.
You will not be considered as a listed company because the condition is your securities are listed in the recognized stock exchange in India, then you are treated as a listed company. If you are not recognized, you are not registered in India, then this will not be applicable. Got it?
Got it, sir.
Then, subsection 4 says, the central government may by notification exempt class or classes of public companies referred to. So some of the companies can be exempt from the requirement of public issue, right issue, etc. These provisions will be exempted. So this is another section. So as such, lots of amendments are there, but the time is lacking. Today, I thought I will cover up at least 10 to 20 amendments, but the time is gone. And I had kept the time up to 7 o'clock. So, when do we meet again?
Saturday, sir. Saturday, Sunday, okay.
Coming Saturday, Sunday?
Yes, sir.
Saturday, actually, I have my own class. How about day after tomorrow? We start little late?
Day after tomorrow is holiday, sir. We can.
Day after tomorrow is holiday. Holiday for what?
For Ugadi. I am from Hyderabad, actually.
Okay. So that is a very good day. We can have the lecture on that day.
Very auspicious New Year for the Hindi calendar also.
Yes. So now it's a voting. What time we start day after tomorrow?
Yes. I may request you to start little late.
What time?
By that time, I'll be free from office around 7:30. 7:30 will be fine, sir, if it can be made.
We're going to voting. So one option is 7:30 PM. Another option?
6:30, sir. A bit late, sir. After 8:30.
After 8:30. That is another vote. What next?
6 o'clock.
6 to 6:30, sir.
6:30 is okay, sir. 6:30 to 8, fine.
See, we will take 6:30. 2 hours. Okay. Today's date is 11th. So we are talking about
13th
of April. And the time to start is
6 to 8:30.
Okay, let's do this way.
Yeah, that is fine, sir. 6:30 to 8.
14th is also holiday. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Again, on 13th, we will discuss and schedule one more lecture.
Yes, sir.
See, I really love to deliver you more and more. Take as much as you can from me.
Yes, sir.
Come properly, read and discuss with me. So you will get the clarity on what you have understood. Right. So sir, as much you read, you will get the clarity. If you don't read, then you are going to get what I'm doing on the board. And I'm going to conduct multiple lectures so that everything is taken care of here itself as far as amendments are concerned. Is that fine?
Any recordings will be available, sir?
Recording will be done. I have already told you that the SAP full course will be available free for subscription. Free.
Okay. Right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
You do one thing. Go on Google Play Store. Google
Play Store.
And there is an app in the name of Tile Institute. One app in the name of Tile Institute. Download this app. And very soon I will upload videos and those will be accessible to you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Now, some more little information. I'll take just 2 minutes, not more than that. So we have fixed up this time?
Yes, sir.
Keep it noted. And invite more and more people here. So they will also get to know how these amendments are to be understood. Now, Full Companies Act. Full Companies Act. I have divided that in two parts. Up to section 148 and 149 onwards. All these are video courses, full also up to 148 also. So there are three video courses on Companies Act itself. This I called part one, this is part two, and this is Full Companies Act. And on this, new videos will be uploaded from 15th of this month. And by 5th of May, we will upload entire law. So depending upon your exam and your syllabus, you can choose which one you would like to have. That is about the regular course. These amendments, we are covering. So who has? So the complete list of the information has been given to you. What will be there in the part one? Shruti, you can put part two and three as well. Yeah, this is about the part two. And about the Full Companies Act also, you can put the information. So how many of you are you newcomers in my lecture today?
Me, sir.
I am the newcomer, but I have seen your recorded classes in YouTube.
Okay.
I was very fond of seeing, and the way you explain with the chart, never ever seen, making it very simple.
Thank you. Lenovo, this is old and new syllabus, doesn't make a difference. Law will always remain same. Tejal is new. Thank you, Tejal, for being here. Aur kaun kaun naye log hain?
Hello, sir.
Yes, please.
Yeah, sir, I have a question. Sir, I'm Gaurish here. I will be appearing for CA final November 21. So this entire Companies Act I wish to join, but this how about allied laws, or what would we suggest regarding?
I know, but I will do that also.
It
is only CA final if you want to do, or you want to understand the entire company law?
I want to understand the entire company law.
Then this is the portion for you, right? Otherwise, CA final syllabus starts from 149 onward. That's why I have done that intentionally from 149 onwards. So if you really want to
understand the law, this will help me for exam size, well, right?
So you take this one and the light laws. In any case, I will do in the month of May.
In the month of May, yeah. So if I join for entire company course, it would be fine, right?
That will be fantastic, because you see, once you clear your CA, you will never read company law again. This is the only time when you can really read and understand law. And as far as my explanation goes, I always tell, don't remember law. Don't try to cram law. Understand it and it will be for lifetime. Right. So I'll make you understand law. So n number of amendments and you will still understand what a law is.
Sir, IPC lecture.
IPC will be this portion up to company law part one.
Sir, IPC or IBC, what are you talking attend?
About? Yes.
Sir, if I want to attend these live lectures, they are starting from 15th, right?
That will be recorded again. So you can give me a call. My number is, you have my number?
You are there on that group, no?
I'm there on the group. And once again, I'm writing my number here. So you have any information to talk about, you can call. Give me a call.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Thanks a lot.
With that is another advantage I offer to my students for the online courses, that I am always directly accessible to them. Never ever it will happen that somebody from my office is picking up a call and telling you that I'm not available. It will never happen. I'm always accessible when you're doing online courses with me.
Yes, sir.
Nice to hear, sir, this.
So that is the way, because the purpose of your being here is learning and my purpose is teaching. So we should be accessible to each other.
Yes,
sir. It is a nicely presentation, sir. It is easy language also.
Thank you.
You can easily remember also, sir. No problem.
So be there day after tomorrow at 6:30 and invite maximum number of people. We can accommodate up to 1,000 people here. So invite more and more people. So let them see the benefit what they can get by learning the amendments.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I will go into more details on that day.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So
sir.
What is the name of the app? Name of your app, sir?
IELTS Institute.
IELTS Institute. I'll show you here. Just 1 minute. Okay. Just 1 minute. Shruti, you can put the link of the app. Can you see this one? It is a little. It is out of focus by chance. But only by the Thail Institute you will find that. I'll share the link. Shruti, you can share the link here on the chat.
The US is not clear, sir, but you can show.
Yeah. Yeah, the camera is actually far off, so otherwise I cannot take it closer to the camera.
Yeah, that's what it is not. It is not very clear.
Let me see if I can show you clearly.
Okay.
Just 1 minute.
Okay, sir. But anyhow, you already subscribed. No problem.
No, the vision is not clear.
Yeah, clear. It is not clear, sir.
Anyway, the link will be shared on the group, so everybody can download. So download maximum.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you.
Okay, and there is one free speed reading course also that will also be given to everyone.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, so see you day after tomorrow with
okay,
more, and more people. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir.